Good morning, brothers and sisters. Welcome to our service today, and I'll get Reverend Edmund to light the second candle for the second week of Advent.
Morning, church. This is the second week of second Sunday of Advent, so we light this candle as a symbol of Christ the Way. May the word sent from God through the prophets lead us to the way of salvation. O come, Emmanuel.
Please rise. A voice cries out, "In the wilderness prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God."
Let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him.
Come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Indeed, Lord, we adore not only the baby that was born in Bethlehem at first Christmas, but we also adore the Lord who was crucified and bleeding from the cross. And we also adore the King who said he will come again in glory and with his angels, who rule and reign once and for all. Father, we come before you as your people, Advent people, people who live in the now and not yet, people who live between the first coming of Christ and the second coming of Christ. And we adore you. Father, we pray that until the day when you come in triumphant victory, you open our eyes that we may see glimpses of your kingdom. You open our eyes, Lord, that we may see, God, how we can be witness to you, how we can be your salt and your light, and how we can bring your hope to this world around us. So, God, even as we worship you through this season of Advent, open our eyes to you. As we prepare to celebrate the birth of our Lord Jesus, help our hearts to also long for the second coming of Christ, for the day where there will be no more tears, no more sorrow, no more diseases, no more pain, the day when all that is wrong will be put right. And until then, God, help us. Help us to be your agents and your witnesses in this world. So we praise you and we thank you and we ask that you lead us in this time of worship and service and prepare our hearts to come to your table. We pray and ask this in Jesus' name. Please be seated.
Let us say the prayer for illumination. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. Today's scripture is taken from Mark chapter 1, verses 1 to 8. The beginning of the good news about Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of God. As it is written in Isaiah the prophet, I will send my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way. A voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him. And so John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. The whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem went out to him, confessing their sins. They were baptized by him in the Jordan River. John wore clothing made of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. And this was his message. After me comes the one more powerful than I, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. Welcome to Holy Covenant Methodist Church. And as you know by now, today is the second Sunday of the season of Advent. And Advent season refers again to the four Sundays before Christmas. And it also marks the beginning of the Christian year. It reminds us that we live in an in-between time between the first and the second coming of Christ. And so on one hand, we prepare to celebrate the birth of Christ at Christmas. And on the other hand, we also wait in anticipation for his second coming. In Christian tradition, the sermons on the second and third Sundays of Advent usually focus on the strange figure of John the Baptist. And that is why my sermon this morning is entitled, Who is John the Baptist? Now, apart from his sudden appearance in the Judean desert, nothing very much is known about John the Baptist. Well, Mark, in his gospel, he locates the gospel of Jesus, the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, with the appearance of John the Baptist in the desert. You notice that Mark's gospel doesn't bother to give us any background story about the birth of John or the birth of Jesus. But we do know a little bit about John's birth from the Gospel of Luke. The births of John the Baptist and Jesus actually forms a set of parallel stories. There are very similar parallels between the birth of John the Baptist and the birth of Jesus. Firstly, both of them had their births foretold by the angel Gabriel. Both were born under strange or difficult circumstances. Elizabeth, John's mother, was old and advanced in age, well beyond childbearing years when she had John. Mary, Jesus' mother, was young and unmarried when she had Jesus. And also, both their births fulfilled prophecies of long ago, prophecies that were told long ago. In fact, John's gospel also tells us another fact. Elizabeth, John's mother, and Mary, Jesus' mother, were relatives, which means John the Baptist and Jesus were also related. Now, John's father was Zechariah the priest, and when John was born, he prophesied about his son in these words, "And you, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go on before the Lord to prepare his ways." After this, we have one more brief verse in verse 80 that summed up the rest of John's life before he appeared in the desert preaching. And that is in verse 80 that we read, "And the child," referring to John, "continued to grow and become strong in spirit, and he lived in the desert until the day of his public appearance to Israel." So we know that John was no stranger to the desert. In fact, he lived in the desert until he publicly appeared to Israel. Right? Until it was time to proclaim the message that he had been given. Now, John had a unique appearance, to say the least. Right? He was clothed with camel's hair, and he wore a leather belt around his waist. His hair and beard have probably never been cut. If we were to see him today, we would call him a caveman, right? A barbarian, maybe, a caveman. But he was already out of fashion with the people of his time, right? So don't even need to mention our time. Maybe one day, you know, the way fashion goes around, maybe one day it will become fashionable again. Right? But his fashion sense with the people of his day was actually earlier 800 years. Because he was dressed exactly like Elijah the prophet. In 2 Kings 1:8, we read, this is how Elijah dressed. Right? So they replied, "He had a garment of hair and had a leather belt around his waist." The king said, that was Elijah the Tishbite. And we compare it with John's description, John's appearance. John wore clothing made of camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. Now, of course, this was not a coincidence. The Jews were waiting in anticipation for the prophet Elijah, who had not died, but was taken up to heaven in a chariot of fire. Each year, when Jews celebrate the Passover meal, They will leave one cup of wine untouched for the prophet Elijah. And they will leave the door open in case Elijah comes. There will always be a seat ready for Elijah in their homes as they celebrate Passover. Now this was significant because the Jews believed that when Elijah came back, that would be the sign that the Messiah was coming. Elijah had to come before the Messiah. And when we read the description of John the Baptist and the description of Elijah, as we have seen previously, now we begin to understand what is going on here. John the Baptist is the new Elijah, standing at the dawn of a new age. Perhaps that is why when John the Baptist made his public appearance, so many people flocked to hear him, even though he was in the desert. Now, I'm not sure if it has ever struck you, but the desert is certainly not the first place I would choose if I had an important message to proclaim. So the strangeness of John the Baptist extends even to the location he chose for his message. In the Judean desert, beside the Jordan River. I mean, if I had an important message to proclaim, I would do it where most people are, which is certainly not the desert. In John's time, that would have been Jerusalem City. I'm sure our own experience, we have all been ambushed by some kind of sales promoters selling all kinds of things, right? Along overhead bridge or outside the MRT station, right? For example, I mean, there's a link bridge between Ng Teng Fong Hospital and the Westgate Shopping Mall, which I sometimes go because it's near office. And there are always some kind of salesperson promoting something along that link bridge. And I always try to walk on the other side to avoid them. But you get the idea, right? No one will employ these promoters and send them to a deserted place, like maybe Sungai Buloh. Right, you won't send them, you go and market for me these things at the Sungai Buloh. Right, they will send them to where there are people, right? Unless you're marketing product or goods. Okay, so the desert was a strange place for John to proclaim his message. And the desert would have been inconvenient for John, for the people in John's time to get to. It is some distance from the city. Some people may have to borrow a neighbor's donkey, you know, to get there. Some may have to make the journey on foot. They don't not so fortunate to have a donkey. They may have to walk their own way to the desert to hear John. And mind you, walking along the way on foot, you may meet robbers or bandits. So they run the risk of having their possessions robbed. Why would they go out of the way to hear this strange guy in the desert? After all, if they wanted to hear from God, shouldn't they go to the Jerusalem temple? Because that's where God's presence is, isn't it? Or maybe they should sign up for more religious classes or make an appointment with one of the chief priests for a Q&A session. But still, they came. All the country of Judea was going out to him, and all the people of Jerusalem too. Now, not only were the people going out of their way to hear John, they were also being baptized by him in the Jordan River, confessing their sins. Do you know what a radical act baptism was for the Jews? It was a very radical act for a Jew to be baptized. Right, most of us here have been baptized. Now, even if you are not yet baptized, you would still know what baptism is. It is not something totally new to you. That's why we usually, when we read this verse, we think nothing much of it. But in the time of John the Baptist, baptism was a shocking symbolic act. Why? Most pious Jews already understood themselves to be God's people, God's elect. And how? What is the sign that they are God's people? The mark of circumcision, right? So they already, because they are circumcised, they know that They belong to God. That is the mark of their covenant, the covenant with God. Right? In contrast, the Gentiles were uncircumcised. And that was how Jews saw the world. Right? In black and white. Either you are circumcised or uncircumcised. Right? You're circumcised means I can hang out with you, I can go to your house, whatever, and I will have no dealings with the Gentiles who are uncircumcised. But John's call for the baptism of repentance challenged their notion as God's people. Many of them took their status as God's people for granted. And thus, it was no small thing for the Jew to be baptized. It meant that he cannot boast, he's not boasting about his circumcision as a descendant of Abraham, but rather was to repent and bring forth the fruit of repentance. Not only that, remember, circumcision is only for males, right? Male Jews. But John's baptism of repentance was for everyone. Even the women could be baptized. Even the children could go out to be baptized, right? And so the call for baptism of repentance shook the Jews out of their comfort zones. Indeed, the sacrament of baptism, which is so familiar to us today, so common to us, was not so common in John's time. And it was a radical, symbolic act. This brings us to a point of reflection. We see here that it can only be a work of God that could get so many Jews to leave their comfort zones, to leave even their most important religious symbol, the temple in Jerusalem, and venture out into the desert in search of God. In addition, it could only be a work of God that would cause them not to look at their circumcision as a mark of pride as God's people, but to humbly confess their sins and even allow John to baptize them in the Jordan River. Sometimes we need to get out of our comfort zones in order to encounter God. Perhaps the people in John's time were looking for something that they could not find in the organized religion of the temple back in Jerusalem. Maybe it was the murmurings that at last a prophet of God had appeared again after a deafening silence of about 400 years. Remember, in between the New Testament and the Old Testament, there was a period of about 400 years of silence where there was no prophet, no sign from God, no word from God. And finally, now there are murmurings that a prophet has appeared. And what is more, there are rumors that it was Elijah, the prophet. So yes, it was inconvenient to go out to the desert, but the air there is also fresher and cleaner. And in the desert, John offered them a chance to come clean, to stop pretending that they were someone else, and to start all over again. There, they could be eyewitnesses to the new thing that God was doing in their midst. Our God is an all-present God, whether in the desert or in the Jerusalem temple. But sometimes, we can be so comfortable where we are that we fail to hear His voice. Or we do, but we brush it aside because we are afraid of the discomfort that will come our way if we obey Him. Brothers and sisters, where is your desert? Where is the place that you pray with all your heart that God, please don't send me there? What is the thing you pray with all your heart that God, don't ask me to do this, please? I think all of us have some idea where our own desert lies. And we have a long list of all the good reasons why we should not go there, or why we should not do this thing. We are comfortable here after all. But sometimes, just like the Jews in John's time, we can only really be present to God and hear His voice when we are shaken out of our comfort zones. After John the Baptist has preached his message and baptized the multitudes, he would also finally baptize Jesus, the one that he came to prepare the way for. And after he baptized Jesus and Jesus' ministry begins, John fades into the background and is not mentioned anymore until his death. How did John die? He was beheaded by King Herod and his head placed on a platter. But there is a backstory to that. King Herod had divorced his own wife in order to marry Herodias, his brother Philip's wife. And thus he committed the sin of adultery. Now that was not all. It turns out that Herodias was actually his half-niece, because she was the daughter of his half-brother, which means Herod also committed the sin of incest. Now John the Baptist told Herod off about his sin, and Herod therefore had him in prison to shut him up. Now Herodias, Herod's unlawful wife, also nursed a grudge against John and wanted him dead. But Herod, King Herod, was afraid of John, knowing that he was a righteous and holy man. And so he kept him in prison, but safe, and even occasionally listened to John. And then Herod's birthday came, and he threw a big party. During this party, Herodias' daughter performed a dance, which pleased King Herod so much that he offered her any request, offered to grant her any request, even up to half his kingdom. Herodias seized the opportunity and told her daughter to ask for John the Baptist's head on the platter. And that's how John the Baptist died. His horrible death at the hands of the authorities gave us a preview of Jesus' own death. In time to come, Jesus would also suffer a horrible death at the hands of the authorities. And we can see that the parallel that we can draw between John the Baptist and Jesus extends from their births all the way to their deaths. Now, the Bible actually mentions very little of John the Baptist when compared to Jesus. And that is right. That is as it should be, because John was here to prepare the way for Jesus. But from whatever we can read about John the Baptist, we know that he lived his whole life with one purpose: to declare the arrival of the Messiah Jesus. He feared no one in his mission, not even King Herod or his unlawful wife. His whole life and death was a witness to the Messiah, to point away from himself and to Jesus Christ. John the Baptist shows us what our lives ought to be about as Advent people, as people living between the first and the second coming of Christ. We too are called to be witnesses of Jesus Christ. How are we to do so? One of my former church members is a real estate agent, as I've mentioned before, I think, and he witnesses for Christ by not taking part in any unlawful schemes that grants him kickbacks, even though many other agents in the market are doing the same thing. Right? So he insists on not doing anything. He insists that gives him illegal kickbacks, illegal benefits, or even lying through the marketing of the property. He does not do that. Another couple I know, in fact, Joseph and Li Ping, Joseph came to speak to us this year during our social concerns Sunday. Right, they witness for Christ by being foster parents. In so doing, they provide vulnerable kids with an environment of love and care. Now, Joseph and Li Ping already have three boys of their own. And they recently completed the adoption process for one of their foster kids. So now they have four kids of their own. This boy is their foster kid whom they adopted. Right, the other three, whose faces you can see, are their own boys. Right? And the last one whose face is blocked is another foster child that is living with them. Abel Ang, Group CEO and Director of Advanced MedTech, which is a company valued at US $200 million, he witnesses for Christ when he chooses to stay in a HDB flat, even though he can easily afford something more luxurious. And he uses his money to help About 100 of the most disadvantaged children overcome their learning difficulties. He shows us, his life shows us what it means to say, when God gives you more, you should increase your standard of giving, not your standard of living. So what about you, my brothers and sisters? How do you witness for Christ? If you haven't realized, you are the answer to today's sermon topic. Who is John the Baptist? The answer is you. You are called to bear witness to Jesus Christ in your life. You are called to prepare the way for his second coming. Maybe we don't have to dress out of fashion like John the Baptist did. But the things God may call us to do will sometimes seem very out of place, out of fashion with the world. Why not join in the illegal kickbacks? Since everyone is doing it and you get to benefit from it, you will stick out like a sore thumb if you don't. Why bring trouble on yourself by fostering other people's kids, even adopting kids that are not your own? Don't you have enough trouble or worry bringing up your own kids? Why live in a HDB flat when you can easily afford a big landed property? In this Advent season, we are reminded that we are all John the Baptist. And perhaps God is calling some of us out of our comfort zones to the desert where we can really encounter him. So my dear Johns, will you prepare your way for the second coming of our Lord Jesus Christ? Let us go to God in prayer. Lord Jesus, today as we come to your table, we are reminded that you commanded your disciples to observe the Holy Communion until you come again. And so, God, we are reminded that you are the King who will come again. And today, as we look at John the Baptist's life, we are reminded that you called us, each one of us, who now can receive your Holy Spirit, who now have the power that raised Christ from the dead. That same power is also at work in us today. You call us to prepare the way for your second coming. You call us, God, to witness for you in our daily, ordinary lives, in our waking up, in our family life at home, in the life when we go to the market, in our life when we go for our walks, in our life when we cook at home, in our life when we meet with friends, in our daily, ordinary lives, you call us, God, to prepare the way for you. And sometimes, God, for some of us, we may have to leave our comfort zones in order to hear you speak. But whatever it is, God, help us to obey you in what your Spirit is speaking to us today. And so help us, God, to prepare the way for the Lord, to make straight his path, to level up the valleys, to tear down the mountains that stand in the way. To come and speak to us, continue to lead us and guide us as we reflect this Advent season. We praise you and we thank you in Jesus' name.
May I invite all of you to rise to respond to the God words. The Apostle Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of sins, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us remain standing. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin, and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Shall we go to prayer and confess our sin to God? Let us pray together. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. This proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. So let us offer one another signs of reconciliation and love. You can punch your fist, can wave and say shalom to each other. And remember to smile. Well, we can't see your smile, but your eyes will smile. Shalom to all. As forgiven and reconciled people, let us offer ourselves and our gifts to God. Let's prepare our hearts for offering. As you come forward for offering, please maintain social distancing, and on the left and right of the wall, there are the QR codes to pay digitally. I invite all of you to rise and let's say the prayer for offering. Compassionate Father, we thank you that you are our strength and our song. You filled our hearts with joy. May we give our offerings to you with gladness and joy. Everything we have belongs to you, and we rejoice to give some of your abundant gifts back to you. Bless the tithe and offering we give today. Let the majesty of the Father be the light that guides us, the compassion of the Son be the love that inspires us, and the presence of the Spirit be the power that empowers us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Please remain standing. Continue with a brief thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets, who looked for that day when justice shall roll down like waters, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream, when nation shall not lift up sword against nation, and neither shall they learn war anymore. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, whom you sent in the fullness of time to be a light to the nations. You scatter the proud in the imagination of their hearts and have mercy on those who fear you from generation to generation. You put down the mighty from their thrones and exalt those of low degree. You fill the hungry with good things, and the rich you send empty away. Your own Son came among us as a servant to be Emmanuel, your presence with us. He humbled himself in obedience to your will and freely accepted death on the cross. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of this, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and cup. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ and one with each other and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, and with your Holy Spirit in your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now let us pray the prayer that Jesus has taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace. Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one loaf. The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. The cup over which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. We invite all baptized believers to partake of the Holy Communion. There will be two stations in front. You can just come up and go to either station and then receive the elements and wait for everyone to get it, and then we will partake it together. Off the top layer, the bread. Brothers and sisters, the body of Christ given for you. Let us partake with grateful hearts. The blood of Christ shed for you. Let us drink this with grateful hearts. Post-communion prayer together. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
Brothers and sisters, now it's time for family news. You may scan the QR code on the screen for this week's e-bulletin. And we warmly welcome everyone to the on-site worship service and those watching from your home that's online. Especially if you are worshiping with us the first time today, we hope you'll be blessed. We're seeing some familiar faces and also new faces among us. So God bless you and thank you for coming to the worship today. Okay, there's a few items in the bulletin to take note. Okay, to take note that for next Sunday, 13th December, there will be a second offering collected for the Methodist Schools Foundation. So what is actually this Methodist School of Foundation? It's an institute of public character. They support 16 Methodist schools in Singapore, and their mission is to provide holistic education for our children within Christian environment. And the purpose of this fundraising, okay, is to upgrade facilities and teaching aid, and also to prepare next year, 2021, the bursaries and financial assistance to needy students. So just a little bit more info. In the last 23 years, there are more than 9.5 million being given out and helped thousands of children, and they have benefited from it. So MSF believe that every child, regardless of the family circumstances, they deserve the best support. So your love offering will help to raise our next generation of Christians from within our Methodist schools. So every donation counts, God be all glory. So pray about it and get ready for that second offering for next Sunday. Okay, the next news, okay, for there's new bishop for our Methodist Church in Singapore. So Reverend Dr. Gordon Wong will be the new appointed bishop for the next 2021 to 2024. And Reverend Dr. Chong Chin Chong will retire and he's given the title the Bishop Emeritus. Okay, and the next news is about our on-site Christmas service on 25th December. Because of the restriction of 100 pax in per worship, our congregation will be divided into two groups. Okay, you will register via this link. I will send it through the WhatsApp chat group. And next week, I think our poster will be up. We have a QR code for you to do the registration. So for English service, we will also open up 100 pax. So we will have group A and group B. Okay, so it's similar like the 11 a.m. Mandarin service. Group A will enter and exit via the door that is on the canteen side, which is on my right. Okay, group B will enter from the door, okay, via the car park side, which is on my left. So when you register for English service, as we know that usually we do not exceed 50 pax. So when you do the registration for that Christmas service on the 25th, okay, try to fill up the Group A seats first. So when you register, if Group A still have remaining seats, please register there first. Okay, then you can go and carry on with a Group B registration if Group A has already been filled up. All right? So it will remain similar for the Mandarin service, as our church is more than 100 pax, so we can't have a normal, you know, combined service as usual. So for Christmas service, we will be as usual. That's two, not the usual, but like the usual Sunday like now, we have two sessions, the English and the Mandarin. All right. So this is the QR code and the poster will look like this. So look out for the posters next week that we're going to post up. Okay. If you want to be in our WhatsApp chat group, you can come to me after service. I will add you into the group. Yeah. So this is what it looks like, and you will register through this link and not the normal link. Okay, just for your information, as we're testing on the link itself, we accidentally opened a 25th Sunday link on a normal registration for the Sunday service. So there's actually six packs who have registered, but I have cancelled and refunded. There's no cost involved, okay, but I've cancelled the attendance. So those who have registered accidentally on the other 25th Sunday, please re-register yourself for with this new link for the 25th Sunday. It's a new event under the church. Yeah. Okay. Okay. And next is on the Christmas Sunday, it will be a baptism Sunday itself. So these are the names that that joining in for the baptism, infant and child baptism, confirmation, and transform membership. Keep Edward, Yuen, and Paris in your prayer. There will be the baptism and confirmation from the English congregation. Okay, and the rest will be in the Chinese, the Mandarin congregation. So do keep them in prayers too. That's all for family news today.
I invite you to stand as we receive the benediction. And so, my dear John the Baptist, please go out from here and prepare the way of the Lord. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you now and always. Amen. The service is over. God bless you. See you next week.